Hello everyone, I am Professor Pallavi Devkate, welcomes you in next lecture of Econ 242, course title is Agricultural Finance and Cooperation. In previous lecture, we studied about classification of agricultural credit, in which we see the classification of credit on the basis of time period, purpose, then on the basis of security, on the basis of contact with farmer, then activity oriented loan, then on the basis of liquidity, etc. In today's lecture, we are going to learn about sources of agricultural credit. Okay, so this sources of agricultural credit and the agency of agricultural finance are the same thing. That means these sources of agricultural credit are also called as agencies of agricultural finance. Okay, there are two kinds of agricultural agencies, in which first one, that is non-institutional credit sources, and second one is institutional credit sources. Okay, so we see one by one these two different sources of credit. Okay, so first of all, non-institutional credit agencies. So this non-institutional credit agencies play an important or dominant role in rural areas for agricultural finance. Okay, so these non-institutional agricultural credit agencies are landlords, traders and commission agent, then money lenders and relatives. So these four agencies are included in non-institutional credit agencies. Okay, so in 1951 to 52, these non-institutional sources accounted near about 93% of total need of agricultural credit, and institutional agencies accounted for only 7% of total credit needs. Okay, in 2002, the non-institutional agencies accounted near about 38.9% of total credit requirement in agriculture. Okay, so first of all, we study in detail about non-institutional agencies. Okay, so these non-institutional agencies include first, that is landlords. They are mostly small and tenant farmers depend on landlords for meeting their production and day-to-day financial requirement. That means whatever the small farmers as well as tenants depend on landlords for their agricultural financial requirement. Okay, so this landlord is the source of finance, has all defects which are related with non-institutional sources. That means in non-institutional sources, the interest are very high, and also there is cheating of small farmers out of their lands, and the landless laborers are forced to become a bonded labor. Okay, so this is the first non-institutional source, that is landlords. Okay, after that, second source is traders and commission agent. So these traders and commission agents advance loan to agriculturists for the productive purpose against their crop without completing legal formalities. That means whatever the traders and commission agent, they gives the loan to farmers for productive purpose against their crop. Okay, and most of the time these traders and commission agent force the farmer to sell their produce at low price and charge heavy commission for themselves. Okay, so this traders and commission agent source of finance is particularly important to the farmer growers of cash crops and fruits or orchards. Mostly these cash crop growers, fruit orchard growers are use this source of credit. Okay, so in case of this traders and commission agent, it often becomes obligatory for the farmers to buy the inputs and sell output to them. That means whatever the inputs, that inputs buy from that particular traders and commission agent, and also they forced to sell their produce through them. Okay, these commission agent and traders charge heavy rate of interest on that particular loan, and also this commission on all the sale and purchase of that particular commodity. Okay, so this is the one of the major source for orchard growing farmer as well as cash crop farmer, that is traders and commission agent. Okay, after that, third source of non-institutional agency, that is money lenders. Okay, so this money lenders, now rapid development, the rural branches of different institutional credit agencies are there. So village money lenders are still dominated in rural areas. Okay, so these money lenders are of two types. In that, first one is agriculturist money lender. So this agriculturist money lender are the lender who combine their money lending job with farming. That means the main occupation of this agriculturist money lending is farming plus lending of that particular money. Then second type of money lender is professional money lender. So main occupation of that particular professional money lender is money lending. Okay, that means this professional money lender, the main occupation is money lending, whereas third type of money lender, that is village shopkeeper. That means this village shopkeeper along with shop, he also lend the money to the farmer. This agriculturist money lender as well as professional money lender, they charge high rate of interest on their loan. Okay, then next, under money lender, there are some reasons due to which these money lenders are more popular or predominant in that particular rural areas. In that first one, that is they meet the demand for productive as well as unproductive requirement. That means these money lenders can give the loan for productive as well as non-productive purpose. Then second one, that is they are easily approachable even at all hours. That means we are taken loan from that particular money lenders at any time. Then they require very low paperwork and advance are given against the promissory note or land. That means in case of money lending, there is low paperwork or there is no any paperwork, and this money is advanced against the promissory note of that particular farmer or against the land. The lending method is simple and elastic. That means in case of money lending, the money lenders, there is very simple method of money lending and elastic. That means according to farmer's convenience, this method can be changed. Then easily accessible and maintains personal contact with farmer. That means these money lenders are easily accessible and these money lenders maintain personal contact with farmer. And also this money lender has local knowledge and experience, and on the basis of that particular local knowledge and experience, they advance loan to different farmers on the basis of their requirement. Okay, this is the next source of non-institutional agency, that is money lenders. Okay, after that, last source is relatives and friends. That means these relatives are mostly helpful to solve the temporary financial difficulties of farmer. At that time, the farmer borrows the loan from relatives and friend. Most of the time, these relatives and friend do not charge any rate of interest. That means these loans are given on free of interest rate. Okay, so these loans are to be returned after harvest. That means according to convenience of that particular farmer or borrower, these loan can be repaid to that particular relatives and friend. Then disadvantage of this loan is mostly the loans are used for unproductive purpose. Mostly these relatives and friends are given the loans to the unproductive purpose. Okay, so these are the some non-institutional sources of credit which are used in agriculture. After that, next one, that is institutional credit agencies or sources. In that first one, that is cooperative bank. Second one, that is commercial bank. Third one, government. Then Next one, that is RRB, Regional Rural Banks, then NABARD and Microfinance. Okay, so this non-institutional sources, these non-institutional sources gives the credit with or without any rules and regulation. But in case of institutional credit agency, there is proper rules, regulation and formalities for lending of loan. So we see one by one these different sources of institutional agencies. Okay, so under institutional agency, first source, that is cooperative bank. Okay, so this cooperative bank, there are different cooperative credit societies, and that first one, that is PACS. So long form of PACS is Primary Agricultural Cooperative Credit Society. So this PACS working at village level, and it provide short term loan and medium term loan to the farmer. Okay, then next one, that is DCCB. DCCB, it is District Central Cooperative Bank, and this DCCB working at district level, and it support and supervise and guide the PACS and also advance loan to the farmer as well as PACS. Then next one, that is SCB, State Cooperative Bank. So this State Cooperative Bank is apex bank in cooperative three-tier structure. Okay, so this State Cooperative Bank supervise and provide guidance to DCCB. Then next one, that is Land Development Bank. So this Land Development Banks provide long-term credit loan to the farmer. Okay, so this Land Development Banks are of two types, that is PLDB and CLDB. So PLDB is Primary Land Development Bank, which is located at block level, and second one is Central Land Development Bank. It is working at central level. Okay, after that, next cooperative agency, that is FSS, that is Farmers Service Society, and next one, that is LAMPS, LAMPS, long form is Large Size Adivasi Multipurpose Cooperative Credit Society. Okay, so these are the some cooperative societies or bank which provide financial support to the farmers. So some of them are provided short term, medium term loans, and some of them like Land Development Bank, which provide long term loan to the farmer. Along with provision of this credit, this cooperative society also gives some other services, such as provision of different agricultural equipments on higher basis, then provision of different essential commodities through this PACS. Okay, after that, next source, that is commercial bank. Okay, so these commercial banks are of three types. In that, first one is private bank, second one is public sector bank, and third one is foreign bank. Okay, so first one, that is private bank. So this private bank, main aim of this private bank is to earn maximum profit from their banking business. Okay, so this private sector bank are mostly profit oriented. Okay, after that, second one, that is public sector bank. So public sector bank, instead of earning more and more profit, they are engaged in providing maximum service to their client. So these public sector banks are service oriented, and mostly these public sector banks are included all the nationalized bank. Okay, so in case of private bank, for example of private bank is S Bank, Axis Bank, HDFC Bank, etc., the example of private bank. Whereas public sector bank, that means all the nationalized banks are included in public sector bank. For example, Bank of Baroda, Bank of India, then Bank of Canara Bank, all these banks are included in public sector bank. So main aim of this public sector bank is providing maximum services to their clients. Okay, after that, third type of commercial bank is foreign bank. So mostly these foreign banks are related with foreign exchange. That means these foreign banks, the headquarter is remains in foreign country, and they open their bank branches in other countries. For example, American Express Bank, then Standard Chartered Bank. These are the some example of foreign bank. Okay, after commercial bank, next source is government. That means the government, is also one of the source which provide finance or credit to the farmer. Government provides short term as well as long term loans, and they sometimes this government provide direct loan to the farmer, which is known as Takavi loan. That means these Takavi loan are generally advanced in the time of natural calamities, and the rate of interest for that particular loan is very low, and also mode of repayment is very convenient according to farmer. Okay, so definition of Takavi loan. The Takavi loan means the government advance loan directly to the farmer in case of emergency. That loan is known as Takavi loan. Most of the time question may be asked on this, that is define Takavi loan. So Takavi loan is the when government advance loan directly to the farmer in case of emergency, that loan is known as Takavi loan. So this government is not such major source of agricultural finance, but in some extent it provide loan to the farmer. Okay, next institutional source is regional rural bank. So this regional rural banks was established during 2 October 1975, and these RRBs were set up in those region where availability of institutional credit was found to be inadequate. That means in the areas where these institutional agencies was inadequate, in that area these regional rural banks were established. Okay, and the potential for agriculture development was very high. That means in that particular area there is need for agricultural development was very high. In that particular area this RRBs was established. These RRBs are the combination of cooperative plus commercial bank. Okay, so these RRB take some features of cooperative bank and some features of commercial bank. Then the main aim of that particular RRB is to provide loans to small farmer, marginal farmer, landless labor, village artisan, etc. Okay, so main object of this regional rural bank is provide financial support to small, marginal, landless labor and village artisan. These loans are advanced for productive purpose only. Okay, so this is the next source of agricultural finance, that is RRB, regional rural bank. After RRB, next source is microfinance. Okay, so this microfinance through self-help group has assumed prominence in recent year. That means this self-help group is one of the source through which farmer get finance. Okay, this SHG is the group of rural poor who volunteer to organize themselves into a group for eradication of poverty of the members. Okay, they agree to save the regularly and convert this saving into the common fund known as group corpus. Okay, so these members of group agree to use this common fund and such other funds that they make receive as a group through the common management. So this self-help group, that means farmer can get financial support through this self-help group. So this is one of the source of financing agency to the farmer. Okay, so this different sources, that is non-institutional and institutional sources, farmer get finance for their agricultural requirement. Okay, so on this topic question may be asked like enlist and explain different sources of finance, or sometimes enlist the different sources of finance and explain sometimes non-institutional source, or sometimes explain institutional sources of agricultural finance. Okay, so this is about today's lecture, sources of agricultural credit. Okay, thank you all.